My name is Lauren McKinley Ranzetti, and I am an instructor at the AGO in the gallery school. And due to COVID, I'm not getting to do very much teaching in that space, but I do try and get there and visit the gallery as much as I can. And there are some amazing pieces there. And today we're going to be looking at some work by several artists, specifically Mary Reid and Helen McNicoll. And the work that they've done is looking at flowers and still life and small vignettes of moments of time. And so today what I'm going to be doing is I'm going to be drawing from objects that I have in front of me. And I'm going to be asking you to hopefully try and join me doing that. So I want to share with you some of the things I've already got going on so that you know my thought process. So for me, whenever I do a drawing, I always try and do a sketch close up of the items that I'm interested in. And so is it a tall picture? Is it a wide picture? This is just pen and a little bit of watercolor. I try drawing it on just regular paper. This is just a sketchbook for just drawing. And this was looking at the notion of the shadows within the items around, the shadows of the object on the table. I have some pot lights and it's creating some really neat cast shadows, right? And in fact, I thought that was so neat. What I wound up doing was I placed the object right onto my page and I just traced the shadows that were cast by the objects. And that was a lot of fun. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to do a drawing where I'm actually using chalk pastel. It has a really lovely quality to it. Chalk pastel is very chalky, very soft. It's something that you can blend. It's quite forgiving. It's smudgy, right? And it's a little bit messy. So, you know, if you don't like chalk pastel, you can use watercolor pencils or even just regular pencil crayons. You could use markers. There's some really great markers out there. I have a whole set of Tombow markers, have a thick edge and then a tiny edge to it. So a nice point. Working in a Sharpie is not a bad idea. Permanent pen. I did another drawing where I did it in permanent pen and then I did watercolor on top of it. Right. And so the thing that's nice about the permanent pen is it doesn't bleed. And so then you can get some really nice marks that way. So I've got a very light sketch here in pencil, and you might not even be able to see it. I'll hold it up so you can kind of see what I've got going on. Just where I think I want things to be placed in the page. And I'm just dealing with this object. So I'm only working with the lavender and the pot and the shadows that it's casting. And for myself, one of the things I like to do is I like to do background first, and then I will do the foreground afterwards. And this is kind of important with chalk pastel. So I'm using a paper towel to just clean off the edge of my chalk pastel. And what I'm going to do is I just want to create just a little bit of background atmosphere. Because they're sort of a lavendery gray, I want to use a yellow in the background. So I'm just fleshing that in. It's pretty bright. I might go in with a more muted color afterwards. Now with chalk pastel, it's very dusty. I'm knocking it off. And instead of using my hand to smudge, I'm actually going to just take some paper towel. And I'm just going to put my finger in it and I'm just going to rub it a little bit. I want to soften it. I don't want it to be the most important thing in the picture, so I'm just making it a little bit lighter. And if I wanted to make it even lighter, I could be trying to remove some with the paper towel. So I think I'm going to do that. I'm just going to try and eliminate some of what's there. Soften it up a bit. Still pretty bright, but that's okay. Okay, so that's my background. So I tend to do the background first, and then I move into the bottom of the page, which is in fact the table edge. And I want it to be quite muted, not too complicated. It's a brown table, but I'm going to just use the edge or the side of my chalk pastel. And because it's a wooden table, it's got some lines in it. So I'm just going to go in with a little bit of color. And I'm even going over some of my shadows because, in fact, the shadows are sitting on top of the actual table. And I'm just going to soften that a little bit more by even just rubbing most of it away. Now, the challenge is if I put my hand down on this, I'm going to be smearing into it, and I don't want that to happen. The shadows are underneath the object and behind the object, so I have to actually do the shadows next. The challenge is the shadows are dark, or can be dark. I don't want them to be too dark, but I want to have some shadow in there. And so I'm going to use a chalk pastel that's a gray. If I wanted to help create a more cohesive picture, one of the things I can think about is it's orange in the background and yellow in the background. I could potentially put a little bit of a darkish blue into my shadow below. So I'm going to do that. And this is a bluish purple, but I think I'm going to actually go with a little bit brighter purple and put that into these other areas. Now, so I've got just my basic shadows going on, right? What I think I'd like to do though is I'd like them to be a little bit blended. So I could go ahead and use my paper towel and a finger, but I could also use just a Q-tip. And so the Q-tip is nice because what it does is it actually just targets an area. And I'm trying really hard not to touch the paper with my hand at all. There are things called stomps, which you can use that are paper wrapped. But I find that they just push it around. They don't actually smudge it too much when it comes to chalk. And I'm creating a lot of powder here, so I'm going to be tamping it down and blowing it off in a minute. With chalk pastel, you can also work on something two or three times and before the paper gives way and says, yeah, I can't put any more items on here. So I don't want it to be I don't want it to disappear too much, but I do want it to kind of blend into the background. And I think I'm going to draw with the Q-tip, just adding a little bit more personality to some of this drawing in here. The shadows are a little bit bigger than what I have. I'm just gonna tap that again. So it's a little bit different, right? It's a little bit now, still doesn't look like anything. It's just a bunch of stuff, right? It's not particularly brilliant. I might even go in just with, I'm going to add just a little bit of a blacker shadow at the bottom because there's many, many casts of shadow in here. And if shadows overlap, they wind up becoming quite a bit darker. So I'm going to just put a little bit of that in to play here and rub that as well. And you might need more than one Q-tip if you're doing really dark colors and you're doing them early like I am. You might wind up having the issue of no Q-tip left for the lighter smudging. I'm gonna not worry about it too much because I'm not gonna do very much smudging in other areas. I just wanted the shadows to be very amorphous and very diffuse and not be the dominant aspect of the picture, which they shouldn't be because they are not the actual objects. Okay. So now I'm going to get into the actual flowers and the stems. And the stems have a really lovely, beautiful gray cast to them. Now the challenge is this is really big and clunky and bold. And so I might turn around and say, well, what if I, instead of using chalk pastel, but what if I went in with a watercolor pencil and just did my lines? I think I'm going to actually do that. And so now all of a sudden this is becoming mixed media, right? This is not just chalk pastel. You can use pencil and chalk pastel together, or pencil with oil pastel. So the thing that's nice about chalk pastel is it can be quite impressionistic. You can add quite a bit of personality to things through pressure. And whenever you're drawing, you can also decide what you want to have as a focal point or as color choices. This bottle has a brown or goldish sort of cast to it on top of it. But because I really want to play up the lavender, I'm choosing to not use that goldish color, partly because I don't have it in my palette, in my chalk pastels, without it looking really icky. It's an icky brown. And I want to play up the fact that there is quite a bit of beautiful purple in this lavender. And chalk pastels don't really blend with each other very well just by drawing together. You have to kind of blend it with your either finger or a Q-tip. I'm going to do that now. I just want to soften it up a bit. And you don't have to blend. You can keep some of it quite fuzzy or diffuse or sharp. You decide what kind of personality you want your objects to have. And I've been quite safe with my background. I have not actually put a lot of personality into my background, unlike McNicoll's work, where she's got some really beautiful designs and patterns. And Mary Reid too, the daisies that they have and the chrysanthemums and things like that. There's some really beautiful scumbling in the background. They're painted, so of course they're going to have a little bit more difference than what's going on here with chalk pastel. So then I have my finishing piece is just all of these fabulous fronds of the lavender. And I am purposely not going to smudge these. I'm going to try and keep them sharp. And it's not that they are just one color. I can play around with having a little bit more purple or a little bit more green in there. They're dried, so of course there's a little bit more gray in them than if they were freshly picked. But they still give off a beautiful smell. Now the other thing that you can do too with chalk pastels is you could potentially mix it and blend it with the Q-tip and then go in and be sharp again. So like with this particular bottle, I think I want to try and bring in a little bit more sharpness in with the blue. I wish I had a darker blue. I don't have a darker blue, so I'm going to go in with the purple. You can make things darker through adding black or adding, but that's really dark. I don't think I really want to do that. So I can blend it to kind of pull it back a bit, make it not quite so bold. I was hoping I could get a darker component in there. I can go over it again and it's getting a little bit muddy, but you know, it's okay. It's all right. Not the end of the world. I want to have this to be a little bit fuzzier. The crispness of those lines is almost being lost. And although these flowers are actually very tiny in reality, I am making them a little bit bigger and a little bit more pronounced. As they dried, they shrank. And I think I'd like to have them just a little bit bolder, a little bit more obvious. So depending on what you're drawing, chalk pastels might be really great as background, or you're drawing really large, at which point then you can have lots of atmosphere with the objects. Or you could go ahead and say, well, I actually think I want to have, I want it to be sharper. And so then if you want it to be sharper, then what could happen is you're adding more variety of materials. So I want to just actually go ahead and make this a little bit brighter to one side. And I think I'd like to make the brown a little bit bolder. I find that when I am drawing, I do draw something more than once because I don't get it right maybe the first time because I'm not 100% sure what materials to be using. And then what happens is the very first time you're drawing it, you're maybe struggling with the challenge of how to draw it. And then all the other times you're drawing it, you're just becoming friendly with it and having a bit more of a relationship with the objects and how they interact with each other. And so don't find that just because the first time you draw something it doesn't really work out, doesn't mean you shouldn't try it again, because the second time you'll have, it's not a stranger to you, right? It's something that you're actually a little bit more familiar with. Okay, so here's my finished picture and the objects I was working with. And so it's just, what you're going to do is you're just going to find an object or a series of objects that you like in your house that you feel comfortable with. You're going to try drawing it out in pencil, and you could be drawing it out with tiny little thumbnail sketches that aren't even that big. You could be moving into bigger paper where you're going a little bit larger with the objects. You could be tracing it, tracing the shadow like I did with these other ones. You know, there's lots of different ways to capture what's in front of you. And I hope that you share what you've drawn with us on AGO Makes, which is #AGOMAKES. And then what happens is everybody else gets to see it and I get to see it, because I'd love to see what you've been drawing. And I hope you'll join me again looking at some artists in the gallery and then doing some drawings inspired by their work. So thank you so much for joining me, and I look forward to seeing you again.